In this edition of Art Loft, the curator's collection, Girls Club, featuring visual artist Luann Kolodny.
For a long time, I didn't know what it meant to be an artist. I said, just because I'm drawing or doing video, which is really what I started out doing, you know, what qualifies me to be an artist or anybody to be an artist?
Photographer Francie Bishop Good.
And I always found photography magic, and I still do. In a way, it was my way of seeing life. I don't know, some photographers say it's a shield, but for me it was a way of focusing in on something that you might not be able to see.
And artist Harume Abe.
Many people thought that I was crazy coming here in summer, but actually it's been amazing because summertime, it's wet and Everglades is so lively.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kaylin James. And from Girls Club in Fort Lauderdale, this is Art Loft, the Curator's Collection. Welcome to Art Loft, the Curator's Collection, a series of monthly specials that invite leading South Florida galleries, museums, and local arts innovators to curate episodes based on their artistic vision. Together, we'll discuss the selected profiles' impacts on our arts and local community. In this episode, we're hosted by Girls Club in Fort Lauderdale. This week, we welcome two guest curators, Creative Director Michelle Weinberg and Gallery Director Sarah Michelle Rupert. Ladies, thank you so much for having us, and we'd like to know a little bit more about you.
My name's Sarah Michelle. I'm an artist and the gallery director here at Girls Club.
Fantastic. Michelle?
I am an artist and I have been involved with Girls Club since the very beginning.
So tell us a bit more about the Girls Club. It's a really neat location.
Thank you. The Girls Club is a nonprofit foundation, an alternative art space. We've been here since 2007, producing exhibitions, public programming, catalogs, and web projects.
And all the work that is shown here comes from the collection of Francie Bishop Good and David Horvitz, who live here in Fort Lauderdale and wanted their collection to move beyond the boundaries of their private home. And we happen to be the only collection open to the public in the entire world that is predominantly by contemporary female artists.
The first piece chosen by our guest curators features artist Luann Kolodny. So tell us about Kolodny's history here in Miami.
Well, Luann, in addition to being an artist that works in many diverse media, she played a really big role in founding what is now the Museum of Contemporary Art in Miami. So she was very instrumental in connecting artists and creating a sense of community early on in the days of Miami's evolution before Art Basel came here and brought so much spotlight. So she's a very important figure locally.
She's a pioneer here.
Absolutely.
Now, how does she get started here at Girls Club?
Well, Luann is in the collection, and we invited her to be a part of our Artist in Action series, where we invite local artists, 4 per year, to do a public talk and to release a limited edition multiple for sale. And they also have the choice to do workshops with the public.
Thank you, ladies. Now, Luann Kolodny.
I'm Luann Kolodny. I'm a video artist. I do drawings and installation as well. This is my second career. Actually, it's about my fourth career, but I've been doing this about 15 years now, after I left the directorship of MOCA. Girls Club, they have a guest curator who goes and creates an exhibition, but those two pieces were included in the Follow the Line exhibition, which is currently showing there. For a long time, I didn't know what it meant to be an artist. I said, just because I'm drawing or doing video, which is really what I started out doing, you know, what qualifies me to be an artist or anybody to be an artist? And since Duchamp, anything you do counts for art. So that was one thing that kind of kept me going. But I felt that to be an artist that you had to kind of be validated in some way. The first video that I did was accepted into the very first optic nerve program that the MoCA Museum of Contemporary Art had. So that was pretty good validation. And I'm very interested in psychological ramifications of how society affects us and how culture affects us. I found that a lot of my work kind of turns out to be somewhat on the violent side, which I don't understand totally. And it's not that I'm embracing violence, it's kind of like, I feel like by showing it or looking at it that we will all, you know, kind of recoil from it and hopefully bring about something that is more peaceful in the world. I do like my art to kind of startle. I want you to experience it and kind of tell me what you're thinking. And if you kind of come up with what I was thinking when I did it, I think, Eureka, I did it. I realize that there is a strong strain that you can trace in my work, that it's because some of it does look disjointed. But when I saw it all together, I saw that even the pieces that aren't necessarily like the other work, there is a strong sense of who and what I am trying to do in that work. It does perform a cathartic thing for me, and it gets very personal, and sometimes I will just be stopped in my tracks because it scares me maybe a little bit. So what I'll do is I'll turn to craft to do something that's just really cut and dried and using your hands and kind of not thinking. Well, all of my video is somewhat performative. I kind of regard myself as a found object. I love to perform. And what I did in the boxing video, which is called The Smasher, that's my AKA, this Louis the Smasher Sams, and the thought came to me, yeah, I wonder how many women are out there in the box, and I started getting on the web and everything and found that there's a whole culture out there of women boxers. And so I bought some books and I started studying up on it and found that most of them come to it because in some way they were broken. From that research, I developed that video. A lot of the things that I say as the Smasher are comments that I have read or heard women boxers make. And I think it shows just another phase of society and what happens to people, especially women, when they're not allowed to express their true feeling. I decided I'd just take one of the effects on the video program in Premiere that I had never played with, and I just shut my eyes and I came down, and lo and behold, you know, synchronicity as it is, it hit onto mirrored images. So I started playing with mirrored images and with the idea of chance, because I started cutting the video up and just replacing it and not really looking at it. And then I went back and I made some nice cuts so that it did smooth out and run nicely. And this video of the hands came out. I was going to quit after that. I was really happy with it, and I thought it was the best thing I had done. And it really turned out to look like a metaphor for life. You watch these hands just kind of manipulating, and with them being mirrored, they take on a life and they become something else. And I enjoyed that as well. Those drawings that I did that are in Girls Club, I'm taking those now and I'm taking the, because there's some collage elements in it, and I'm building the collaged elements out at least a half an inch so it becomes like a relief. And I've got about 5 or 6 characters, and they're about so high now, of police officers and people being accosted and things of that sort. And I'm creating a large background for it, and we'll place these on there so it'll become a relief. And I'm also furthering my inquiry into women's boxing. I think there are going to be a couple more videos from that, hopefully.
Now, back to Art Loft's The Curator's Collection. The next selection features Girls Club founder Francie Bishop Good. Francie's photography actively engages her subjects. What is it about her exhibition that spoke to you?
Francie turns her camera on very personal relationships. a lot of family imagery. And this exhibition kind of brought some of her own personal history in front of the camera because she grew up in Allentown, Pennsylvania. And so some of the imagery captures the neighborhood and the surroundings of where she grew up and then goes further afield. There's work from Havana, Susan B. Anthony Recovery Center, which is a residential community for women and their families. And so she got to know people there.
Now the exhibit has a very unique name.
Not on Allen Street.
Not on Allen Street. Well, we can't wait to see it. Now we have Francie Bishop Good at the Art and Culture Center of Hollywood.
When I was 7, we had something called green stamps. And we saved up about, I don't know how many books of green stamps. I traded them in for a camera, a mint green brownie knockoff camera. And I always found photography magic, and I still do. In a way, it was my way of seeing life. I don't know, some photographers say it's a shield, but for me it was a way of focusing in on something that you might not be able to see or that somebody else might not see, but I see it. So it's sort of given me that extra focus, extra vision. And it's also been part of my art practice and my sculpture, my printmaking, my drawing, and my painting, and my photography. It's always been part of it.
You know, sometimes a photographer can be removed from their subject, right, and then others are very much a part of what they're photographing. Nan Golden, obviously being an example from the 80s, she participated in that, and I think you participate with your subjects, like you said earlier, you engage them. And
I'm usually very comfortable with the people, and I wait until their guard's down and we're having a conversation and they forget that the camera is there. The dog and the person and the barbershop with the hair and the whole environment. I have been shooting at the Floridian, which is the restaurant next door, and I just found this whole scene with this girl and then the halo sort of around her head. I just, you know, found it really compelling. I think I was intrigued with the barbershop and the dog. I love dogs.
Definitely, but I also love that the halo is made up of the Florida Lottery. You know, so there's that contrast between this Madonna and then the poodle, you know, and this hair salon that's somewhere on Las Olas, you said?
It was, yeah.
So this like heavenly kitsch.
Not on Allen Street. I grew up on Allen Street, and the show was not on Allen Street, except for actually there's one photograph that's taken on Allen Street. The book is really favorite photographs that we chose from the last 4 or 5 years. And they're all over the place. There's some were in Havana, some were in Pennsylvania, some were in New York State, some were in Florida. But there is a similarity. There is definitely a thread that runs through all these photographs.
I think photography is no different than other kinds of art. So there's an editing process involved. I think, you know, when there's a painting show or any other kind of show, there's still an editing process. The artist obviously is always working. So space-wise or concept-wise, only certain works make sense for like a solo show, for example. There's a subjective element that certain subjects would appeal more to me or more to Fran, as with any other artist.
Everybody comes to a photograph or a work of art with their life's baggage. So what David likes is, many times I know, oh, David's gonna like that one. And it might not be my favorite, but it still will, by the time he gets the photographs to review, it will go through my editing process, which could be thousands, narrowed down to 10.
So there's editing on both parts. So she has to go through thousands before I see maybe, you know, a couple hundred, and then that gets edited down to 10.
Well, there's photographs from the Susan B. Anthony Recovery Center. I've been going there for about 5 years. So mothers and children series. So they're from different series. Yeah. And there's photographs from traveling, from Havana. So this is an old Havana, and I went to see her 3 times. She was really, really nice. And I just like the light, the kind of quality light and the still life on the left.
Yeah, for me, immediately, it looked like I just got this click to painting and to Vermeer. There's something about the way that things are placed, and also that yellow, that is so unbelievable. And all the shades of yellow, and the way that they, I mean, there's these rectangles of yellow and these squares of yellow, all that talk to each other, and then there's that little light right in there that peeks through.
And then the mirror and the kind of reflective aspect of it.
So the and the multi-layers is something I'm interested in. And the, just the way her smoke, you know, we don't really see smoking that much anymore.
Yeah.
Love the way the smoke is right here, and your eye kind of goes like that. That was what? That was, and the way the light hit the smoke, it was just luck.
To create a focal point.
Right.
And her
glasses. So that's why I chose that one. And I like these little touches of bright color. And the little still life on the
wall. Perfect little triangle right there.
I never even noticed that. Camera is always with me. So it never gets easy. As I say to my photographer friends, it's a really hard sport. So when I get a photograph that I like, that David likes, I feel really good because there aren't that many.
You see her ability to capture people in these very personal, private, quiet, psychological moments. And I think that's difficult for a photographer to capture.
This edition of Art Loft is being curated by Girls Club in Fort Lauderdale. For the final selection, we visit Everglades National Park to speak with Aerie artist Harume Abe. So tell us, why'd you choose this piece?
We're a big fan of Harume Abe's work. She's an artist in our collection as well. And what I really enjoyed about this segment was that she talked about a series that she had started with her residency. And we exhibited one of the prime pieces from that series in our last year's exhibition, I Think It's in My Head. And I think she did a great job of not only explaining how an artist functions through these larger projects, but the outcome was really amazing.
Well, I think Harumi's work is, it's getting more and more unusual for artists to stay committed to working in paint as their primary medium. So we were really happy to have someone that's delving into the expressive qualities of paint and dealing with observation and nature. Yeah, we love Harumi's work.
Thank you. And now, artist Harume Abe.
My name is Harume Abe. I'm a visual artist that live in Hollywood, Florida. I'm originally from Japan. I was awarded to be an artist in residence in Everglades National Park. And I'm here for a month as an artist in residence. Yes, I have a Willie and Duke, my best friends. We're in the middle of Everglades. I came here for college and I got married and I stayed. From a series of work called 134 Days and 21 Hours. The title itself actually come from the distance. If you travel from my house in Hollywood all the way to my house that I grew up in Japan, according to Google Map, you calculate the distance in Google Map and it tells you 134 days and 21 hours by walking and kayaking. I thought it was interesting as a different way to talk about the distance and the journey that I came all the way here. So I'm just using that as a somewhat of a symbol to talk about my work. And the whole series of work is about idea of home, the home as a place you live, but also about place you harvest your, cultivate your childhood memory, and that memory you bring it on and you keep recreating that into new homes. So that kind of idea as container of your soul, in a sense. That as well as like the journey to recreate the home itself. So the combination of the two things is the basic idea of the series. Many people thought that I was crazy coming here in summer, but actually it's been amazing because summertime, it's wet and Everglades is so lively. the water gives back life to every plant. And I see so many birds, so many animals. I mean, of course the mosquito is crazy, but you just protect yourself. First week when I first got here, I was scared, absolutely scared, not knowing what's going on. And usually I'm really nervous about bugs, things unknown. Everglades is huge. So I was scared of alligator, mosquito, everything. But once I started like exploring a little bit more and start understanding what's going on, and this is getting to be my home for sure. Some stuff that I've done is a direct observation of what I've seen, and from the photograph reference, I try to do a study of what, you know, what kind of thing is living, like bars and landscape in general. And this is one painting I did, and like I said, I was really scared in the beginning, so it was like really, really dark painting in the end of what came out. I don't think that one behind you is as dark. Some stuff that it really depends on my unconscious mood, if anything. One of painting I'm kind of, it's not good to talk about something that I haven't finished yet, but because, you know, some series of my work is about idea of home. One thing I realized, Everglades is a home for many different species. And I kept seeing so many birds that I never ever think of seeing this many. Like I even saw bald eagle. That was like amazing. So I was thinking about making a painting of a tree with all the birds that I saw all living in the same tree. So that's a little bit more fantasy kind of happy kind of painting. Typical day would be like wake up and walk my dogs, and like just going out really close by is a nice nature trail, and my dogs loves it, so we go to that. And if I have my husband here, he comes in the weekend, we'll go do more bigger adventure like canoeing, or actually 2 days ago we did a slugging. It was amazing. Usually the experience stays inside of me and comes up in completely different areas. Like some of the series I worked before was from the, I guess, in a sense it's a cyber experience. Like I said, I'm from Japan, and 2 years ago there was a big earthquake and tsunami hit in Japan. And my family, my father's side is from where the earthquake hit really badly and whole entire village went away. So like these days from the technology, we can watch what's going on. I was watching the whole tsunami thing in live stream. So that was like in a weird way of my experience of going through some chaotic moment. And this was not as chaotic, if anything. In the beginning, I was a little scared living here, and somehow this became a home. So that kind of experience will naturally come to it, I guess. And this gave me kind of a little bit of a hope to try different kind of national parks. Hopefully I'll go Alaska or something. It would be nice.
You didn't see it? Over there. Go get it. I'm not gonna go. Oh, no.
Thanks so much for joining us this week, and special thanks goes to Girls Club and also to our guest curators, Sarah and Michelle. Ladies, thank you for being with us this week.
Thank you.
We appreciate it. For more information about Girls Club, visit girlsclubcollection.org. And also, you can let Art Loft inspire creativity every day by visiting wpbt2.org/artloft to watch past episodes. And we'd like you to get social with us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at ArtLoftSFL. I'm Kaylin James, reminding you to stay creative. See you next time on Art Loft's The Curator's Collection. This episode was hosted by Girls Club in Fort Lauderdale. And, sorry, was I supposed to stop? I like your nose ring.
Oh, thank you.
How long have you had it?
When I turned 40.
Nice.
I just said, you know what? I want to do whatever I want. I'm 40. Nobody can.
I don't know. I wanted a nose ring, and then everybody warned me against it.
For your career.
Oh, wait. I'm sorry. We're still talking, aren't we? To speak with Ari artist Harumbe. Harumbe Able. Can I do it like this?
Yes.
Right? Welcome. Well, excellent. Thank you so much for having us. We're happy to be here.
Yeah.
I like the curly hair.
In our hair mini segment.
Okay. More words, I keep talking. Sultry. Don't encourage me, Michelle. Yeah? All right. That's how we work our magic.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation and...
In the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.